Hello, and welcome to Focus, the Catholic Answers podcast for living, understanding, and defending your faith. I'm Cy Kellett, your host, and what a blessing to have you here with us today. Catholics are constantly getting stuff blessed. If a priest starts to bless us, we know exactly what to do. Every now and then, someone will show you their rosary and tell you who blessed it. You know, oh, this was blessed by Pope Francis in, 2014 or something like that. But what is a blessing? What are we doing when we're asking to have an item blessed or a person blessed or an undertaking blessed? We asked Father Hugh Barbour, who's gives us a blessing at the end of this podcast, so hang around. Don't forget to subscribe to Focus on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, Stitcher, wherever you get your podcasts. You'll be notified then when a new episode is released. And thanks very much if you've given us that five-star review. But if you haven't yet, you still can. It helps to grow the podcast. Here's Father Hugh Barbour to bless you with a discussion of blessings. It's as a person who's born and raised a Catholic, you get used to blessings. And sometimes the thing that's common, you never stop and ask, like, what exactly is happening here? So let's go right to the most basic question. What is a blessing?
Okay. It's a pretty simple thing from the point of view of the words. If you speak Latin, Greek, and Hebrew, then it's very easy to understand.
So for you and me, in other words.
Right. Because blessing in Latin, Greek, and Hebrew means to speak well of something or someone or some action. Mm-hmm. Bene dicere in Latin. Benedicere. Or if you like the restored pronunciation, benedicere. All right. Elogain, to speak well in Greek. Mm-hmm. Eflogin, if you want to speak modern Greek or church Greek, all right, to speak well, baraka, all right, those all mean to speak well of someone, something, or some action. Now, it's important to know also that in English, the word blessing, even though it begins with a B, just like benediction, which is the word we would use also, his name will be in benediction, or he gave me a benediction, meaning a blessing. The English word for blessing is very interesting, and it's not unrelated to the meaning, the more profound, the deepest profound Christian meaning of this term. The English word for blessing comes from an Anglo-Saxon word, bledan, which means to anoint or consecrate with blood.
Oh, wow.
Isn't that amazing?
That is amazing,
That was from pagan Anglo-Saxon uses, that you would offer an animal sacrifice, and then you would sanctify things with the blood of the animal you sacrifice, which is precisely what you find in the Old Testament in some of the sacrifices in the Mosaic Law, that the blood is sprinkled
on the people.
The priest puts his finger in it and blesses with it. Right. And of course, our salvation is brought about by the blood of the Lamb, that is the Lamb of God, Jesus Christ, whose blood is the ultimate blessing, the ultimate sanctification.
Yes.
So our English word blessing actually is extremely rich, richer than the Latin or the Greek or the Hebrew word, because it actually contains the word blood. If you think blessing, that's the same root as blood, okay?
Okay.
So that's just a side. I won't go back to that. But to bless, there's several ways in which we speak well, and we're speaking here about the things of God. First of all, blessing is a act of praise, where we praise God or his holy ones for their great works. You say, blessed be the Lord God of Israel, for he has visited and sent redemption to his people. Or, bless the Lord, you works of the Lord, praise and exalt him above all ever. Or, bless you, bless your heart. Like all Southerners say right before they
Psalm, and then Southern,
after you've done something stupid, or right after they've said something mean about somebody.
Well, bless your heart.
Well, he is such a hateful thing. Bless his heart. Anyway, so there's that sense of giving praise, first of all.
Okay.
That's the first sense. And that's one to keep in mind, because it's very popular nowadays with liturgists. And we're also end up being kind of the enemies of what we normally think of as blessings, but we'll get into that.
Okay.
So then the second sense of a blessing is when we authoritatively command some good thing to come forth from someone or something.
Okay.
And we have that already in Genesis. It says he blessed and said, go forth and multiply, fill the earth and subdue it, right? So the blessing of creation, meaning to give it the power to accomplish good things in the name of the one who is giving the blessing, right? So that's extremely important aspect. That's what we normally kind of are thinking of, or that's more in that direction of what we think of a blessing, that it gives power to accomplish some good thing.
Okay.
Then there is blessing as a prayer which invokes or prays for the good of someone, right? These are all closely related notions. First, you know, we said praising someone absolutely, then commanding some good thing to come about, and then we have desiring or expressing our desire for some good thing to happen. Like, he blessed me, Lord, help your servant so-and-so and make him prosper and give him your grace, right? So that's another one where we express our prayerful desire for the good of another person. So that the three senses there. Now, normally Catholics are thinking of blessing in a restricted sense, which is not restricted much because it's the same way the scriptures use it. That is that the word blessing has to do with the fulfillment of a priestly role.
Right.
That is that we expect the priests of God to call down his mercies upon us and obtain for us graces and blessings through their own blessing, which is authoritative because it comes from their priesthood. And this is precisely what God did in the Old Testament. We read precisely that God gave to Aaron and to his sons the following order to pray like this. And all of us know this blessing, especially if you're a Protestant, interestingly enough, because Protestant preachers use it more than Catholics. But it is one of the optional blessings in our missal, but you don't hear it very often. But here it is. Maybe you do in your parish, but in any case, you will bless, therefore, in this way, the children of Israel, and you will say, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord show his face kindly to you and have mercy upon you. May the Lord turn his countenance towards you and give you peace. We all know that. And normally the minister holds his hands out, extended in front of him, and blesses the people. That's the first recorded command in the Old Testament of a priest to bless the people, all right?
Yes.
The priest, the Aaron. Now, God blessed us, blessed all the days of creation and blessed us for procreation. So that's the first and original blessing, is the blessing of procreation. Then there's a priestly blessing, which is basically for the protection and the continuance and furtherance of our life on this earth in the service of God, with peace and deliverance from our sins and living in the light of his countenance. But then the Bible gives us numerous examples of blessing throughout the Old Testament, which I won't even go into. There are many, 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 many. They keep going. But let's just fast forward to the New Testament, and we're told by St. Paul that God has blessed us in Christ with his immeasurable blessings. And so we look at Christ as the example, and we look throughout his life, and we see that he was continually blessing people. Now, in the Palestine of our Lord's time, of course, they had come back from the exile into Babylon, and they'd come back. And of course, there was the temple worship with the priestly blessings, but then also they developed the practice of the rabbis, who were not priests generally.
Yeah.
Now, our Lord was, but our Lord was priest in virtue of the new covenant, not of the old. He wasn't from a priestly line.
No.
In the old covenant, but in the new covenant he was, because it's a new covenant and a new priesthood. But our Lord, that we continue to see in the scriptures, he blesses people. He blesses the children. He lays his hands upon them, and he invokes God's blessing to multiply the bread. So many ways in which he blesses. Now, here we understand that the blessing is not only to speak well and therefore to pray well or wish well on someone, but also it's almost always presented, I would say always safely, with a gesture. That is,
what is
the extending
that?
Of the hands.
Yes.
Or the touching with the hands or on the top of the head.
Okay.
Or the elevating joining of the hands. There's some gesture which accompanies it. So it's not to speak well, but also to perform a gesture of blessing.
Yeah.
So, people, if you came up and they gave you a rosary and they said, will you please bless the rosary? And I just folded my hands close to my chest and said, Lord Jesus, bless this rosary. Amen.
They wouldn't like that.
They would be very disappointed because they expect to see my hand making the sign of the cross.
Right.
Because the blessing involves not only words, but also gestures or sacred symbols.
Okay? That's funny because this happened to me and it did bother me.
Right. And I'll explain to you why it happened to you.
I've never thought about that.
I will explain it to you why it happened to you, and it's very unfortunate.
Okay.
But then there's a third aspect of blessings, and that is that we tend to not only have blessings in word to speak well, and as the English word for blessing implies,
to anoint with blood.
To anoint with blood. But this is the third sense. It's not just speak well, not just make a gesture, but also to use some other thing which is already sacred to bless something else.
Yeah, sure.
And so the church continually in her practice, she blesses water before she baptizes. The water for baptism is blessed before she baptizes, even though baptism would be valid even if the water weren't blessed in an emergency, for example.
Right, but right.
So she blesses the water for baptism.
Yeah.
She offers and blesses the bread and wine for Mass.
Mm-hmm.
She blesses oil for the anointing of the sick. She actually consecrates it, the chrism, to mix with the oil for confirmation, for ordinations, for the consecration of altars and in the traditional rite, also chalices and other sacred objects.
Yeah.
Bells, for example, in the old rite,
were
consecrated. They weren't just blessed. They were anointed with chrism.
But like the walls of a church are when you consecrate
walls of the church, right. That's a better example from the current liturgy, although they made it optional. But in any case, if you're ever involved in dedicating a church, of course, if you're ever involved in dedicating a church, don't let them omit that, okay?
No, you won't.
I witnessed the consecration of a beautiful church that belongs to a Catholic college, and they made this beautiful church, and then they didn't anoint the walls because it was optional. So anyway, that's
optional.
We don't like that. Optional. St. Basil the Great would have said optional. Huh. Anyway, optional, you must be a heretic. But anyway, so that's the other thing. The church blesses or consecrates water, oil, other objects for the use of the faithful. Flowers, fruits. And so you have
wedding rings.
Wedding rings are blessed. All kinds of things are blessed, which are either the symbols of the sacraments or the material agents whereby the sacraments are conferred.
Okay.
And so those blessings are of great importance and great power, especially when they touch on the validity of the sacrament. For example, you have to use chrism for confirmation.
Right. And that has to do with the connection to the bishop, I would imagine. Right.
You have to use chrism for confirmation. He can't, as in the Protestant churches, just lay hands on you. He has to use the chrism.
Right.
Marriage, it would be valid if you didn't have a ring.
Yeah.
It would still be valid.
It's good because I've lost it about four times. I know you're not supposed to lose your wedding ring, but this is like number five, I think. All right.
Just don't take it off.
Oh, it's not because one time it came off. It
slips off?
Because I put sunscreen on my kids. And then I went swimming and it just came shooting off. And Father,
stupid.
I have a very...
No, that's just stupid. That's when the devil's just trying to discourage us. So when it happens like that by accident, don't worry about it. Just say that's... Just laugh at the devil and move on, okay? Yeah. And find it before your wife finds out that you lost it. And just joking. Those aspects of blessing there are key, but they're related to the priestly role of blessing, where... A priest blesses something to make it holy, right? Not simply to bless God because he's good and he does good things for us, but rather because we want to make the thing that we're blessing holy. Now, the two ways we can make something holy, by fervent prayer for the person, that's like a priestly blessing you receive, or by a prayer which actually sets the thing apart for sacred use.
Mm-hmm.
Like most strongly with the water of baptism, the chrism, other things that are blessed or consecrated for sacred use, chalices, patens, monstrances, reliquaries, altars, you name it. But then we also have blessings of rosaries, medals, scapulars. We have a plethora of blessings, which are meant to constitute that thing as a sacred object, which should be used only for sacred purposes. There are things that are right in the middle, like holy water.
Yeah.
You know, in the Eastern tradition, you drink holy water. No.
Oh, you do? I didn't know that.
Yeah, you drink it. Yeah, I don't sprinkle it.
I should join the Eastern Church. I got to ask you about one, though. I'm just a little getting concerned about the time. I apologize for that, Father. But okay, so with this, there's one other one that you're not quite hitting on, and that's like when you go to Gloucester and before the fishing season starts, the priest comes out and blesses all the fishing boats. Mm-hmm. He's not setting the fishing boats apart.
And that's a different, that was exactly the next step.
Okay.
It takes to see we're thinking along the same lines.
All right.
That is a blessing which is invocatory, not constitutive. They have constitutive blessings which make something holy.
Right.
Invocatory blessings which ask for God's blessing and grace upon them. Those blessings are renewed continually, like the blessing upon the family during the meal, a blessing of a particular activity like that, that happen annually or relatively often, depending upon what they are. But that's that third kind. You bless God because he's so good. You you make things holy by the authority of your priesthood to accomplish certain holy effects, or you ask for something as a priest or as a layperson, as a blessing from God for those who are present, their protection in soul and body, like blessings on travelers, such things that have to do with circumstances or activities of human life. So you have basically the blessing of God, which occurs practically continually in the divine office of the church, praising God. Then you have the things which make things holy for sacred use and to be channels of divine grace. And then you have the blessings which ask for what you need in order to accomplish the activities of human life. Right, that's the powerful consideration there. But blessings are things that we should ask for. You should ask a priest for a blessing whenever you see him or when you're leaving him after a good period of time, because the priest's blessing is significant and it has a power of itself, not like that of the sacraments, but to the prayer of the church and your own faith is a very powerful thing. So you should always take advantage of that possibility.
Is it only the clergy who can give a blessing, or is there?
There are the people that are the most privileged to give blessings are priests.
Yeah.
And then, of course, in the medieval dispensation, kings, because they're the fathers or parents or queens of their people. But also parents, and many Catholic parents have not learned or have forgotten. But in Europe, the tradition was always that parents bless their children. Now, traditionally, among Latin Catholics, priest blesses people using his hand, making the sign of the cross. But the laity bless others by using the thumb and tracing the sign of the cross on the forehead.
Right.
And Catholic parents should do that every night for their kids before they go to bed, when they go to school in the morning. But the parental blessing, either from the father or the mother, is a very important thing. And it's part of the parental power. You have something which is in line with God and the angelic hosts all the way down to the governance of your children, which has a real effective power in their lives.
Okay.
And also gives them the consolation and awareness of their being under the blessing of those who have the care for them.
Right.
So definitely parental blessings are very important. So all you have to do is just put your thumb on the child's forehead and just say, in the name of the Father and of the Son and the Holy Spirit, or may Jesus and Mary keep you, or may your guardian angel bless you, whatever you want to say. But a blessing like that is a very important thing, and it's something you have the right to do. Because in the Bible, priests, kings, and fathers and mothers are the ones that give blessings.
Well, I have adult children, and I still do it.
Yeah, absolutely. There you go.
And the least the
how do they turn out?
They're horrible people. they're very good people. But I feel like that's my privilege as a father. And even if you don't want it,
absolutely,
I don't care. I don't care. I'm blessing you. I don't care. Even if you're in a bad mood.
I saw that in Italy, a new bishop visiting after he'd been made a bishop, and he knelt down on the ground while his little old mother blessed
God
him on the
bless
forehead.
Him. Isn't that beautiful? There you go. Yeah, that's right. Yeah. All right. Well, I'll ask you for your blessing then.
Absolutely.
May we?
Beata Maria Virgine Intergente, cum omnibus sanctis Domini, benedictio Dei Omnipotentis, Patris et Filii et Spiritus Sancti, descendat super vos, et maneat semper.
Amen.
Amen.
With his blessings and his exorcisms, and most especially in his establishment of the sacraments, Jesus unveils the world of spirits to us, a world that is constantly having an influence on us, but we are not aware of unless he shows it to us. Among the things he left us are these blessings and people who have the power to bless us. They're very, very powerful. It's wonderful to be Catholic and to have this great array of gifts that God has given us. So get some holy water
get your rosary blessed, and take advantage of all the blessings that God makes available. Thanks for joining us today on Focus. Don't forget, we love to get emails, and we have been getting more and more emails from folks who suggest new programs that we might want to do. You can contact us at our email address, focus@catholic.com, focus@catholic.com. Don't forget to like and subscribe. If you're watching on YouTube, please do like and subscribe. And also, we can use your support. It costs money to do this. We've got a crew of people that puts these things together, and we got to pay them. They got to eat. And you can support us by going to givecatholic.com, givecatholic.com. I'm Cy Kellett, your host. Thanks for being with us. It has been a blessing, and we'll see you next time, God willing, right here on Catholic Answers Focus.